What is your stake in Iowa's future? Iowa State University at Ames, through its Cooperative Extension Service, is helping 50,000 Iowans discuss this subject. The county extension offices have helped people organize into discussion groups and have provided free material to help with the subject matter. The topics discussed on previous programs have been, what do freedom and democracy demand? What does growth require? And what prospects for agriculture and Main Street? Today's topic is what prospects for families and communities. In our studio to investigate the question, what prospects for families and communities, we have a group of people representing various occupations. They'll be debating this topic in just the same way other small groups are doing in get-togethers all over Iowa. Meet those to take part in this interchange of opinions. Mrs. Hugh Loudon, a homemaker from Grinnell. Mr. Carl Hamilton, editor of the Iowa Falls Citizen and the Hardin County Times from Iowa Falls. Mr. Cy Warland, a farmer from Fort Dodge. And Mr. Lloyd Larson, general manager of Lennox Industries Incorporated, Marshalltown. We now join the discussion on what prospects for families and communities.
Future, that's true. So what is the future?
That's right.
And many people feel that prospects for communities are closely associated with industrial development. Let's each one of us give his idea on Iowa's need for industry. Carl Hamilton, why not have your idea about this first?
Well, the need for industry in Iowa is very great. They tell us that the movement of people from farms now represents the greatest mass migration that's ever taken place in this state. We've seen it in virtually every county now. The only way to overcome that or compensate for it is to create jobs. You create jobs by building the industry you have within your communities or attracting new industries. I think it's number one in the state of Iowa.
As we're building new industries, I think we need to keep in mind that as we do have a new industry in our town, we also create jobs other than those definitely responsible to the industry. We need new housing, new schools, new public utilities, and those also create jobs for the people.
That's very true, and I don't think anyone would disagree with the statement that at least the right kind of industry in a community is one of the big corrective factors to the future of Iowa.
What do you mean, right kind of industries?
Well, I think there are times when we get a little bit off of the real truth of the subject when we talk about getting industry into a town. I say the right industry is the industry that is compatible with the community and its facilities.
In other words, the attitudes of the communities, I mean, do all people want their town to change? Does this have any effect on whether you really want industry? Will your town and your community be the same if you...
It won't be the same. But I have a feeling this question you're raising, does everybody want industry? The case histories all over the country of, well, we could have had John Deere or Ford Motor Company in our town, but somebody, some old crusty, didn't want to change. I think that's different. I think every community now, concerned as they are about declining farm numbers, wants industry.
Well, Mr. Hamilton, you're in the newspaper business, and you're pretty close to this subject.
Oh, indeed.
Industry is one of the lifebloods of a community.
Right.
Whether it has to be acquired, a new one coming in,
or built,
or the best one, which is the one that's built in the community,
right,
from a small start and grows into a large one.
Yep.
That's been our history in my own community.
It is, definitely.
Out of some 45 industries there, the principal ones grew from nothing to importance right in that one community. They learn to fit themselves, and the people fit themselves to the industry.
Now, Mrs. Loudon, I think we should talk something about families. Now, how do you feel, what prospects are there for families when you get a growth of the industries in the state?
Certainly it will change the pattern of living for families, and I think it will take more counseling on the part of parents, probably on the part of school counselors, for young people to decide what field they are going to go in, especially farm young people. I live on the farm and am more interested perhaps in the future of farm young people, and many of them will not be going back to farming. And I think they need to have a lot of serious counseling to know what they can go into. Perhaps there'll be farm-related things they can do, but still.
Are they doing that? Are young people being counseled in this field so that they realize this great change taking place?
I think they're beginning to, but we certainly need more counselors.
Mrs. Loudon, that's an interesting point of view. When you speak of counseling them as to what they should do, what would be your approach at this time? How would you counsel them, and what would be your advice?
Well, I certainly would give, first I would give them the advice of getting all the education that they could have, because in any field it's going to take education and advanced education to become successful in whatever field they take.
I think this is real interesting. I wonder how good a job are we doing with education in our state, and how important is it to the future demands? I mean, what's your opinion about this, Carl? Do you feel that we should be doing a better job, or are we doing a good enough job on this?
Oh, we aren't doing anywhere near a good enough job. I think we have upgraded our whole elementary education of a vast amount in the last decade. But you talk to the seniors that go out of our various high schools and go off to college, they'll come back and tell you that we have some pretty great deficiencies in our educational system when they get thrown into competition with other young people that have come out of the bigger high schools or come from high schools in other communities. I think we've got some real deficiencies to overcome in Iowa's educational system.
Well, I wonder if that's correct, Mr. Hamilton. If it is as much a deficiency in our educational system as it is a deficiency amongst ourselves in taking advantage of that which is available. Is it not true, it's my own personal opinion, that the big job comes in the parent and the young person of convincing them that life isn't going to be worth living unless they do take advantage of their educational proposition?
That's right, but your young person cannot go into a high school where there's 10 in the senior class, for instance, and find himself in a very stimulating situation or a very competitive situation, at least not on the level that he will encounter once he steps across the threshold of even a small college.
Well, I'm wondering about this now. Are we doing enough? We've had, of course, several years ago, I think we had quite a crying demand for, should we have more science in our schools, and I think probably we went that way a little bit too much. Now, Mrs. Loudon, I'm wondering, should we be doing more in vocational training, particularly for these people you're remembering talking about from the farm? I mean, these young men and women who are going to have to leave the farm, are they competing as well as they should for jobs in the cities or out of the state where they're going?
I think vocational training certainly would be an advantage to them. I will agree with Mr. Larson that a lot of the determination of how a youngster does in college is what he is taught to do by his parents, how he manages his studying. And I think we can even go back to the grades in saying that we need to do a lot more work in teaching young people how to think and how to study.
Of course, right in this sector, it's well to realize, what do we talk about? Do we have 40-45% of our kids going on to college now? Which means we've got 50 or 55% that go from high school, if they ever finish it, and try to take jobs in the 45 industries that
and
you talk about.
That's the disturbing thing to me. The importance of education, the value of advanced education, is known. It's the lifeblood of the future, let's say, or for the future. Yet we find that 40 or 45% only of our people are taking advantage of the facilities we have to better themselves and stand up to the world as we today know it.
But are you suggesting that all our high school graduates should go on to college? Can go on to college?
I think that would be wishful thinking. If it was possible, yes, that certainly would be desirable, but that perhaps will never be.
Well, a young fellow, say a young man from farm coming into your factory down there, Mr. Larson, I mean, do you feel that some vocational training would help him in competing with those fellows? He has to compete with somebody to get a job in your place.
Well, you're touching on a very interesting factor, and it's why industry is one of the more desirable states for industry. You find the lad off the farm who's had experience with machinery, mechanical devices, is far way ahead when he comes into our plant to work than the young man that's grown up in school and only had to handle a lawnmower.
But would you have him have some vocational training other than vocational agriculture?
Certainly, if he wants to advance, and who doesn't, any educational, vocationally, to train him for a better job higher up is worthwhile and should be accomplished, and we do our part in that, we think.
Well, we've sort of agreed on one thing at least, that the schools are important in this problem of how do we get the industrial development. But of course, along with this, how do we finance these schools? I am very conscious that as a farmer that the property taxes have been carrying a large burden of the school tax load. Now, what do you think, Mrs. Loud? Now, how are we going to finance these schools? Do we get bigger and better ones and a lot more of them?
Certainly it takes money to finance schools, but I do agree with you that property taxes are certainly high enough, but I think there are other state taxes that we can adopt to help pay for schools rather than federal. I feel that if the federal government pays for our school system, people will shirk their responsibility, and it's so far removed from the source of income that we don't take our responsibility. And I think that perhaps there is the feeling that there might be federal control if we have federal help for financing schools.
Warland, could I ask a question? In view of the question you have just made, are we getting the full use out of the investment we now have in schools when we run them for 9 months of the year only and start them out at 9 o'clock or whatever it is in the morning and quit at 2:30, 3:30 in the afternoon? Is the investment paying off as it would in an industry or business, or should we consider that angle?
This is a real good question. I know Mr. Hamilton would be glad to answer that. What do you think of it, Carl?
Yes, but we'll have to have another program in which to do it. I think it is a good question Mr. Larson's thrown up, but I believe that we'd better pass for the moment. But I'm glad to have that question raised repeatedly, because I do think, and it gets kicked around at the state level, and it is. We're building a new $1 million junior high building in our town, $850,000, and as you say, it'll sit idle 3 months out of the year.
I think it brings up another interesting thing. We have a lot of other community public services. Do you feel that we're getting our returns from these? I mean, are our tax dollars being spent as well in our county government and all the other public services?
Si, could I go back to this federal aid to education that Mrs. Loudon brought up here? I think she dealt that a rather glancing blow, and not one with which I wholly agree by a long shot. Now, we're plenty happy to have the federal government come out and help us build our interstate highway system. We're plenty glad to have the federal government come here and support this very institution, Iowa State University. Nobody has any complaints about that, or the Federal State Extension Service that I know you're a big booster of, Mrs. Loudon. Furthermore, right here in Iowa, the biggest thing we're doing is educating our kids and exporting them. We're educating them with this property tax that you say is as high as it can go, and exporting our educated product. Selfishly, we have a very great interest in having some federal aid come in to help us educate these kids if we're going to keep on educating them and exporting them as we've been doing. I would like, I'd just like to have federal aid education brushed off quite as lightly as you did it, Mrs. Loudon.
Yet if there was time to discuss it, I think we could all come to realize that we talk about not being able to raise taxes anymore, yet you get federal aid from the get federal aid in schools, and that tax dollar shrinks in size, so that which we could have provided locally for a dollar will cost us $2 and $3 when it gets into the realm of federalist systems.
Of course, all areas can't provide that same dollar. I mean, it's yeah, lots easier, we know, for New York State, for instance, to provide a level of education up here than it is for Louisiana, and yet we are a United States of America, all interested in about the same educational level, we hope.
Well, I know.
Now, excuse me for interrupting.
This is a real good discussion. Don't ever hesitate to
You had brought up something else.
No, I'm still going to get back to what about the public services. I'm going to ask Mrs. Loudon if she thinks we should put several counties together. There have been a number of studies made of this. Should we consolidate counties and get better efficiency? How do you feel about that in your part of the state?
Perhaps if we really could do a more efficient job, I would agree that it would be a good idea. But I feel that we have 23 miles to drive now to our county seat to do our county business, and I feel that that's just about far enough, unless it were quite a bit more efficient than it now is.
Of course, you've got situation, you're more extreme. We've got a county in the southern part of the state that has, less than 9,000 total population now, about the size of some of our larger county seat towns. And those 9,000 people are supporting county government, all the roads, the schools, and several municipal governments. I mean, it's a back-breaking governmental load that's loaded on 9,000 people down there. I mean, it's well to say we've got to go on as we are going, but we've got to recognize that when you drop down 9,000 people in the county, it's a burden I just can't stand.
But doesn't it come back to that old, call it an adage, that if you want to dance, you have to pay the fiddler?
Yes, but do we realize how much it's costing us to pay this fiddler? He's been here a long time, and we go along shelling it out each year. But we have real problems of financing local government when the population drops off as it has in some areas.
I'm wondering if it were sort of this way about a tax dollar. We'd like to see we'd like to get as much back for each tax dollar as we possibly can, particularly if it applies to someone else, if it didn't affect our county. I mean, you suppose there's some possibility of that, or it applies, the same way schools or anything else. Do we have some of the... Do you think there's a point there that we overlook as we're a little selfish in that?
I think we're all a little selfish in our wants and a little hesitant to try something new.
Now, we have a lot of organizations in all our communities. Sometimes I think we are probably the most organized people there could be. Now, do you feel that do you know of any good examples of what organizations are doing, what they can do in making for industrial growth and better family living in the state of Iowa?
Well, I think there are excellent examples all over the state. And I think that you can do in a community almost anything you really want to do. In our town of Iowa Falls, I counted up one time, was horrified to find we had, I think, nearly 80 different organizations. And each in its own way is doing something that it, and I would have to agree, is doing fairly worthwhile. But to all focus on a single objective is very unusual for all of these groups. Now, we did, in our place, focused our entire and total energies, and we accomplished something in building a new junior college building that people said just couldn't be done. And I could go on to our neighboring town of Ackley. They had a plant going out of business, and all of their energies went into this project. They kept that plant going. I'm sure you can do almost anything, but maybe we're not sufficiently alarmed yet so that we are all pulling together.
In other words, it takes you have to have some real issue, some real
right.
need to get people to work together for this sort of a thing. Now, Mr. Larson, I'm sure that coming from a town that you have quite a lot of industry, you must have had some organizations down there that have done something about it in Marshall Town.
I think that the organizations that make up a community, and we have several of them in Marshall Town, are very potent assistance in any measure that you want to accomplish. It comes back to the fact that our good American people will rally if they are well informed. The lack of information is the thing that causes most of our problems. And in Marshalltown, I think we've had outstanding success. Might cite the fact that we built a mental health center in our community a few years ago. But the education to the people to make them appreciate and realize the need of mental health care was done through our various club ladies' organization and men's organization for two or three years before we ever moved. We just completed a drive for a new hospital in Marshalltown. Close to $1 million that's been raised on top of another hospital that raised a sizable sum, done through the aid of organizations. I wonder if we use them enough.
Of course, I just like to have us talk about towns as big as Marshalltown. It's a delightful place. I don't discredit it here, certainly not
Thank
on this
you.
Program. Mr. Larson is my neighbor. But I'm thinking of the little towns, 1,000, 1,500. There's too often a feeling of helplessness, well, there isn't a thing we can do. Actually, that isn't the case at all, because people make prosperity. And you can go in your own trade territory, Mr. Larson, there around Marshalltown, in some little community, some one or two or three outstanding individuals, and have really started projects that have changed the whole direction there.
But I still think that even in a small community, the Ladies' Aid Society and the other groups, once they are imbued with the spirit to help, it's much better than having something like that than just to have to sit down and talk about your neighbors.
I think you are very right, and I think that we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that we should be working for better communities rather than bigger communities.
What is it,
particularly?
All right, what is a community now?
That is hard to define, too. I think of our community.
What
as,
is your town now?
Well, Newburgh.
Well, is there a town of Newburgh?
There is a town of Newburgh, and it is certainly a completely rural town. We have a rural church. We say a rural school, although it is consolidated with the Grinnell system now, so that it is part of the Grinnell reorganization system. But still, our interest is in the local church and the local school. And to me, that is my community. But when you think of industries and other developments, then Grinnell also is my community. And I think we have a hard time defining where our community really lies.
Well, I think we've got to think in larger terms. I think when you talk about industry, we've got several good-sized towns in our county of Hardin. Well, any place that an industry would go in to Hardin County, I don't care whether it comes to Iowa Falls or not, it'd be good for all of us. And I don't think we've yet channeled your... getting back to this question you raised, I don't think we've yet channeled all our energies on this most important problem. We've gone off splintered, as you will, each of us thinking about it in our own way, both within the little communities of Newburgh and as you get to the bigger one of Grinnell. I think we need to think in larger terms.
I think this is real true. I think we have a tendency to think of our own town, or as farmers, we probably think of our own county. I think we have to think of probably what can Northwest Iowa, what can Northern Iowa do to promote something, because a lot of our smaller towns, I know this is true of our smaller towns, we have a lot of people, it's growing, they're building houses, a lot of these people are living there and driving into a larger town where they might be, where they are working now. So I think one of the things that will help families and communities are in these smaller towns, and there's a real problem is that these people probably might be able to live out there and go into some area that's fairly close. They drive quite a ways to work in some city. I imagine you have fellows coming in for quite a ways.
Oh, yes. There are people in our plant, and I know in other large plants in Iowa, where they're driving as far as 75 miles. Matter of fact, since Iowa got out of the mud road era and went to paved roads and automobiles, communities have expanded themselves automatically without any effort on our part.
And changed.
There was a better theater in the town over there than we had, so we automatically drove to that moving picture theater. I think it's expanded normally.
But I think we're prone to think of our community as being our little local community, and we don't see as far as we should.
Of course, to broaden this completely out, should not the state of Iowa be doing more in this field? We're an agricultural state. Our whole heritage is more corn and more hogs. It's hard for us to think suddenly of the fact that more of our income comes from the industrial dollar than from the farm dollar. And we're all quite concerned about this out-migration. And our public institutions, including Iowa State University, the State University, and our state government, help us identify the problem. But we aren't getting a lot of help, frankly. Not critical, but we as a population haven't demanded it.
I saw some figures the other day that I thought were very interesting when you compare the agriculture and industry and the fact that we need both.
Right.
With industry now representing nearly twice the income in the state of Iowa.
Is it twice?
Agriculture. It consumes less than 4% of the total acres in the state, which leaves 96 and some more percent still available in agriculture with half the income of the 3% in acreage devoted to industry.
Well, I suppose probably as farm people, we sort of feel that now for cities to grow and have more industry, we feel that's sort of a problem of Chamber of Commerce and whatever town we're thinking about. Now, what place or what part do you think the agriculture can play in this? I mean, what can we do to help you fellows along? I mean, we talk in a community, but really we think, well, if, for instance, Iowa Falls over in Hardin County is going to grow, this is pretty much the responsibility of Iowa Falls. So this is my responsibility living as I might have lived on a farm out 4 or 5 miles from the county.
But if you lived 6 miles from Iowa Falls, you'd be just as interested, if not more so, in seeing another 100 jobs added in that town as the businessmen are. We've got farm wives working in our town. They're coming in. They need to. And our farmers are underemployed. We know that as bigger machinery has come in. I think it's just as important.
I think it's a wonderful question Mr. Weiland asked. And it would be tapping an unused reservoir. Today, too many farmers, I believe, more or less could resent or resist the advent of industry, at least not be interested in it. But when they realize that they are the fortifications that will aid them out there 15 or 20 miles,
yes,
it's really worthwhile. And that we as communities must depend on the farmer, the agricultural, to aid us, and in turn, we aid them.
Of course, I'm suggesting, really, Si, that farm organizations are just as much interested in this as anyone else in Iowa, and we should be making our interest known in this in the state legislature and here at Iowa State University and the State University of Iowa. What can we do to create jobs here in this state? And we aren't making much noise about it. We're still pretty much agricultural oriented when it comes to our whole educational system, our whole governmental processes in Iowa.
What do you feel, Mrs. Loudon? Now, you were mentioning about your own small community, your own church, and your own school. Do you think that for your family, now, do you think families are looking forward to this town growing? What would it do to your church and your school? Do you think your families would like what it would do, or do you think they...
I think they would. I don't think it's going to do anything very much different to our rural church and our school. I think that it will certainly bring increased opportunities to the young people. They will have more opportunities to do different kind of things in other groups and in other organizations. They will be subject to perhaps some things that we don't like as well, but I do think that the young people need to be associated with the adverse kind of things while they're still at home and can learn what is right and what's wrong.
And it could be a real help, you feel, to our farmers or our farm families.
You've been listening to the last in a series of programs on Iowa's future. Those discussions today have been on the subjects on what prospects for families and communities. The discussants have been Mrs. Hugh Loudon, a homemaker from Grinnell, Mr. Carl Hamilton, editor of the Iowa Falls Citizen and the Hardin County Times, Iowa Falls, Mr. Cy Warland, a farmer from Fort Dodge, and Mr. Lloyd Larson, general manager of Lennox Industries Incorporated in Marshalltown. Iowa State University at Ames, through its Cooperative Extension Service, has provided materials for small discussion groups to meet in homes and talk over Iowa's future, just as these folks have. If you're interested in getting the free discussion aids, go to your county extension office. This has been the final program in this series on your stake in Iowa's future. It's hoped that these programs have stimulated your thinking on some of the current problems we face. The series has not been presented to advocate any specific course of action, but when people study problems of a state or nation, they are better prepared to guide it as voters, as community leaders, or as legislators and congressmen. Remember, if you'd still like to get in a discussion group like the one you've just seen, get your free materials at the county extension office.